Welcome back to Tagata, Pasifika. We're always keen to hear your thoughts on the issues in the show. Drop us a line on Facebook page or Twitter. Now, the struggle of West Papua is to gain its independence from Indonesia has for the most part been unreported. An international media ban has kept the lid on what's been going on over the past 50 years. But thanks to social media and Papuans in exile, what's become known as the Forgotten War is slowly coming to light. Tangolotele Osone Okesene has this story.
The plight of West Papua can't be ignored when you witness guerrilla-style performances like this one at Wellington's Pasifika Day this year. Mary Joko Ponifasio is one of the few West Papuans living in New Zealand. From a young age, she lived with her parents in political exile.
I don't feel right. You know, I've looked at how my parents have been very educated, but have to leave everything behind and go to a foreign country, learn a different language and start all over again, just because of safety for us children.
The island of New Guinea is the largest in the Pacific. The east is part of Papua New Guinea, and the west has been governed by Indonesia since 1963. They laid claim to it from the Netherlands, despite the desire by local Papuans for autonomy. Rich in resources like timber and gold, Indonesia's had a ruthless control over the region, with numerous allegations of brutal repression. All West Papuans want is freedom.
We're an island that's rich in resources. We have the world's largest gold mine, and there's vested interest in it. So any trouble on that island, it would be more of a hindrance to the wealth of Indonesia.
With a long-standing ban on international journalists in the region, the plight of West Papuans has been largely ignored by the world. But in recent years, online campaigns have helped put West Papua's struggle in front of a global audience.
Oceania Interrupted is a collective of Māori and Pacific women who aim to empower collective action through using visual and performance art to call attention to the human rights situation in West Papua.
They've been interrupting public spaces with a number of styles of performance with specific references. Their first paying tribute to Philip Kama, jailed for 15 years for raising the Morning Star flag, the West Papuan flag of independence.
We formed as a collective of women who interrupted the space of Queen Street. We used a flash mob approach where we formed what we call a circle of solidarity around the flag bearer, and we raised it 15 times up and down Queen Street in honour of the 15 years he is serving in a jail in Jakarta.
This year they appeared at Pasifika Festival with this piece titled Morning Star, hashtag Free West Papua. The women mourn the death of one who was laid beneath the Morning Star flag. Thanks to groups like Oceania Interrupted, the message is being heard, and there's growing hope for West Papua.
I was amazed at how these women, young women, were fighting for my country with such passion. They must be amazing women. West Papuans want to be known as a West Papuan Melanesian nation. Once they do that, they have a voice internationally. Right now, they can't.
And joining us today is the director of the Pasifika Media Centre, David Robie. Thanks for joining us. And he's kept a close eye on the media coverage of the issues for West Papua. And also joining us is Victoria University graduate, Solomon Islander and West Papua activist, Francesca Rex-Horoi. Good morning.
Good morning.
Morning, Mark.
First of all, David, what's the latest on the news that you've seen coming out of West Papua?
Well, actually, I have to say there's actually a little bit of good news in the last couple of days because of a video from the human rights group Tapol and also MRG, which has highlighted killing of teenagers back in December last year. Because of that become coming public this last couple of days, and there have been protests for months now, the Indonesian authorities have announced that there will be a full inquiry into those killings of the teenagers. But also would like to highlight the fact that the people of Vanuatu and the government of Vanuatu have been awarded this week the John Rumbiak Award for Human Rights for their contribution in keeping the West Papuan cause alive.
We're seeing the pictures here on screen, which are absolutely atrocious. And I guess it's really been a media blind spot, hasn't it, in New Zealand? Why haven't we seen more of this coverage?
Well, it astounds me because I guess as a journalist, I first started writing about West Papuan issues back in the early 1980s or even before then. But I particularly remember the Nuclear Free and Independent Pacific conference in Port Vila, where I interviewed Rex Rimakek and a number of other leaders at the time. And so it's always seemed to be a big story and a major issue on human rights concerns, but a major story for security for the whole of the South Pacific. So it's always astounded me that New Zealand media, by and large, have ignored it, apart from the honourable mention of Radio New Zealand International, which have done a good job.
And how difficult is it for journalists to actually get in and report or to get the
story? Well, this is one of the problems, of course, is because it's so difficult for journalists to get in from anywhere, particularly New Zealand. It's meant that very little has been put in the way of resources. Largely, journalists have had to go in undercover. Up until about 2 years ago, and there was a change of policy by the Indonesian authorities, and they said, well, we've got a more enlightened policy now, and it is possible to go into West Papua. In practice, there's been no real change, and journalists like Mark Davis last year exposed that quite well in a television story.
Now, of course, there's been a lot of interest by journalists like yourself, but Francesca, you know, as a student at Victoria University, you became quite interested in it. Tell me, what drew you to the conflict?
Being a Melanesian, I think I almost by default feel a sense of, you know, solidarity with these people by my ethnic lineage. But then again, I mean, this is in the Pacific. It's so relevant. It's happening, you know, it's largely eluded the gaze of the international community. And the kinds of human rights abuses happening there warrant international intervention and attention. And
let's detail it. Let's see how bad really is it? Like, can you give me some examples?
So it is difficult to ascertain exact figures, but there have been estimates of between 200,000 and 400,000 West Papuans killed since the Indonesian occupation in the 1960s, and those numbers are difficult to confirm because of that lack of access of the media on the ground. So, I mean, but by and large, that is a huge number. And I mean, if you think about it, that's almost half the population of Fiji if you're looking at the upper scale.
Torture.
It's horrific, really.
You know, it's everyday occurrence.
Yeah,
rape.
Torture, rape, psychological and physical trauma inflicted upon the families. And a lot of it is public humiliation. So this is actually conducted in front of, you know, children's mothers and aunties could be raped in front of them. Their fathers might be disemboweled or killed in front of them. And, you know, with the recent Paniai massacre, children and village elders were shot and a woman was shot as well.
This is happening right in our backyard, right in the Pacific, our Pacific Island brothers and sisters. Why is there a lack of political will from New Zealand or Australia to stand up and get involved? We're sending troops right across the other side of the world, but why not here, David?
Yes, well, we simply don't. Our government doesn't want to get offside with Indonesia, and it's generally taken the lead from Australia, which is certainly not wanted to back Indonesia in any way. And it's actually, I think there's been a change, though. I really detect a change in the last few months, perhaps even to the last year or so, with increasing social media sort of evidence. And I think there's an example with this video that came out about the Paniai massacre that's typical of the sort of information and the evidence that's now actually coming out in the public arena.
I definitely think being able to see the stuff that's happening there, that people are, you know, whether it's students or cell phones and stuff. But how disappointed are you, Francesca, that New Zealand's not doing more?
For me, it aggravates me. Being a New Zealand citizen, my mother's a New Zealander, my father's a Solomon Islander, and both parts of me are in conflict with this issue. And New Zealand is a Pacific Island nation, essentially. You know, we are made up of two islands. We have the Maori indigenous people, and the cry of freedom of the West Papuan people echoes the cry of freedom of many other indigenous communities, the Aboriginals in Australia, the Maori in New Zealand, South Africa, you know, This has happened in East Timor even as well, and we should be taking a stance on this.
What can we do? What can the everyday New Zealand Pacific Islander do?
You know what to do, whatever your occupation is, whatever your passions are, whether you're an artist, a musician, whether you work, you're a businessman, in your communities you can get involved. Encouraging a dialogue on this, a Talanoa, a korero, with people you know, your family, is a step in the right direction. You know, the West Papuan freedom fighter Benny Wenda said any word on West Papua is a step in the right direction.
Francesca, David, thank you both for coming in. We really appreciate it.
Thank you.